And good evening, everybody. Wanted to welcome you to the Murphy Table. We're going to take a quick peek at the Heroes of Normandy tactical card game. Let's adjust some light in here. And this is the print and play off of the website for the Kickstarter. And what I've done is I've printed out the board, put that on some thin cardstock, and then the cards, printed them, try to get them double-sided on cardstock. So they got, it's basically, you know, two cardstock print on both sides. And when I glued them together with a glue stick, just gives them a little rigidity instead of just one thickness of cardstock. Then we've printed the action board. And I got one for both sides. Got the different tokens that they need. So we'll kind of show off some of the tokens and whatnot as we progress. And I'm just going to do just a little playthrough, kind of show you what the game is like, because it's kind of fun. You know, so it's set in the Heroes of Normandy universe. But the difference is, instead of being like a skirmish game with squads and platoons, this is now battalions and companies. And then instead of, you know, on hexes or something like that, or squares, well, it's big squares. So your units actually look pretty nice. You know, the artwork is in the style of Heroes of Normandy. Try to get some light on there. So, you know, I don't know. I think they look pretty good. Even on my print and play printout, they're pretty nice. So the game isn't that difficult. Hopefully I put him back in the right spot. So we'll just kind of walk through how the game is going to work. And, of course, artwork and rules and all that is subject to change. I believe the game is going to come out, it said June of 2017. So the Kickstarter, as of filming this today, which is the 27th of September 2016, so there's still a few months away that things can change. And I found that there are some typos on some of the cards, so that will all change. Now, what's cool with the board is some of these tiles will have symbols. Now, you probably, yeah, you can barely see right here, but here's a symbol. It's a water symbol, forest symbol. Right here, this is a fortified. If you remove the card, it's got trench works and bunkers. And they didn't, you know, like the Heroes of Normandy board game, they put the values for the defense, like, right on the board. So this just gives you the symbol, and you have to look up what the defense value is. That's not bad. It helps get rid of some of the clutter so you can focus on the artwork, which I think the artwork looks really good. I've seen some folks with their demo copies on YouTube, and the artwork looks great. But I think this looks better. I like this for the print and play. Now, let's just kind of hop into it. Now, there is a scenario that I have here on the board. And what I did was I've got it loaded up here on my tablet. That's the rules. So here's the scenario that you get with the print and play. Cleaning of Turkville. Forgive the mispronunciation. So it tells you where everybody's going to set up, what units are involved, and the scenario also gives you a nice rundown of the symbols. Just like Heroes of Normandy, there's a lot of symbology on the cards, which really dictate the play. So the rules, core rules, are fairly short and easy, but all the extra rules comes with the symbols. And so hopefully, you know, as you play the game, you'll learn the symbols and what things mean, and that just jogs your memory. But that's what's going to be the challenge for me, is flipping back and forth to the back of the rule book to get a feel for, you know, remembering all of the symbols. I haven't printed them out. I could have printed those last couple pages of the PDF, but, you know, maybe I'll do that another time. So how do you play? Well, once you have the scenario shows you what units are in play. It tells you how many orders you get per turn, and it tells you who goes first. So in this scenario here, for example, it says, what does it say? Gameplay number, reinforcements. The American player has the initiative each turn. And this is the same scenario I've seen other people play on YouTube who've got like their playtest copies, where we're trying to take this center town. When an American unit gets in there, the American unit gets 2 victory points, and then the German player subtracts a victory point from the American player for each airborne unit that they destroy. And then at the end of however many turns you have, what does it say? setting. How many turns? At the end of the game. Victory conditions. Oh, after the fourth turn. So you got four turns. All right, so that's the basic. Americans are going to take that town, hold it as much as possible, get victory points, and hopefully not die. Okay, so since the American goes first, instead of just trying not to whip the camera around too much, let's just take a look at this board, just in case you haven't seen any other videos of this. With your three orders, you're going to place it on what you want to do, so the nice little reminder of what you can do. You can activate a unit, which activates automatically, and you can do an action, which is like move and fire, fire and move. Take three directive markers. Directive markers are awesome. They're like a wild card. You can do a lot of different actions, and here's the list. You can force an activation, plus one to move, plus one to shoot, plus one to save, or give a unit perforating fire, which is like armor piercing, for a unit that normally doesn't have that. Then you can draw three cards, deploy three cards, swap two adjacent units, and then one of them can shoot. So that'd be cool. You know, activate a unit, have it shoot, and then do a swap and have the next unit shoot. I mean, you know, you can just do little things. And then discard suppressed markers. Certain combat conditions or terrain on the board can actually give a unit suppression, so that will let you get rid of some. All right. My daughter's in the room helping today. So, I might get distracted every once in a while when I see her running around. Okay, refocus. There we go. Alright.
Is that right?
Yes, I see you want that. Okay, get your monkey. Okay. So, with the American player, you can attack. Essentially, you're going to attack one square away from you. You can attack adjacent. Movement, on the other hand, is going to be basically up and down orthogonally. There's no diagonal movement unless you're a mechanized unit. So this unit that I have right here is a rifle company. So I have a couple ways I could activate him if I want to try and fight. I can activate him on my unit board, which will automatically give him an activation. Or I could activate a commander, and then, let's see here. If I activate the commander, down here at the bottom it tells me he can activate anywhere on the board. There's like an unlimited symbol here in the distance. Two commands, parachute units. So if I activate him, this is an airborne unit. It's got an airborne symbol. So I could activate him and someone else. So let's do this. So I'll put a point here, one of my orders, on the activated unit, which will activate this guy. When you activate somebody, he gets a go. When you activate someone using your activate marker, they automatically pass their activation. So I don't have to roll to see if he can do anything. He's going to do it. So he's going to activate his command. So he's going to put a go on this guy, and this is an airborne unit as well. Let's see, but I can activate anywhere. I'm going to activate a mortars. Now, I don't want him to move. Let me shift over here. So I'm not going to have this guy move. I don't need him to move. So I'm going to say his activation's done. Because what you can't do is activate a unit, and since they can move and fire, you can't like move, then do another activity with another unit, and come back. You have to complete everything with that unit before you move on. Well, I don't intend for that unit to move, so I will. I'll move him. Because if I deploy troops, I can have troops deploy adjacent to him. So when his turn's done, you flip him to the activate side. There's been some people asking on the Kickstarter if they could change activate to say activated in the past tense. So there's less confusion between activate and go, because that's kind of a similar term in English. Okay, so now these units here can do something, but because they weren't activated with the star over here on their tracker, they have an activation number. So I've got a couple dice laying around here. So with one die, I'm going to roll that dice. Well, I'm going to attack with mortars first to soften this group up if I can. Now, mortars, to activate, you have to roll that number. So they have a 3. So I'm going to roll a 3. I roll a 5. Good. That means the unit can do something. If I failed to roll, I would just flip him to the activate side. Yes. Thank you, daughter. So what this represents, why they have this, think of it like this. This guy has to send, well, you can't see, I just moved him. The commander has to relay orders out to the field, and they have to receive the orders and then attempt to act upon them. So whether it's by radio, dispatchers, bicycles, however you want to see it, there's a chance that they don't get the orders. I rolled, they received the orders, they can activate. Now they can shoot and move. So when we look at their combat stats, what their ability is, this section here shows their distance. Most of the time you only attack one away, but because these are mortars, and that little distance marker and a 2, which you might not be able to see unless I zoom in, tells me they can attack 2 away, and they get to ignore intervening terrain. So they're going to make 2 attack rolls. Also, if I had a good example of one here, let's take a look at this guy for a second. On some of these cards, you're going to see that commands are grouped together. So this perforation and this number that's grouped, that means this 8 value is a perforating shot, meaning armor piercing. This is a whole other command, if you will, just meaning that that unit doesn't get a save. Now, if this was a separate attack, that would mean everything grouped here counts as an action, or they're linked together, and then that's a separate action. You'll see that with some attacks. So why I'm pointing that out here is that with the mortar unit, their attack is grouped together. Focus. There we go. Since that attack is grouped together, they both benefit from this ranged of 2. So even if this attack was separated, that would mean he'd still have his 2 attacks, but if they were separated, that would mean one attack had their range of 2, and the other attack would be adjacent. But since they're grouped, he's going to make 2 long distance attacks against this unit in the middle. So to do that, I now roll 2 dice, and I have to beat that number of 9. So the first attack misses, second attack hits. So that would be 1 hit. My unit here in town doesn't have any defense built into his card, but he has defense built into the town marker. So he would roll 1 die, and a 6 would be a save of the hit. He rolled a 4, so he fails. So that means, now, that might seem too simplistic, like, wow, that's it, 1 dice roll and they're gone. So you have to think of this in terms of, like, not everyone in that unit has been destroyed. But when you think here, the mortar, this is a mortar platoon. So that's a lot of mortar tubes that are shooting into this area. So what's getting rid of them could be a combination of casualties. Some folks are scared, surrendering. So however you want to look at it, it's not just simply we've killed everyone there. We've disrupted the unit to where it's no longer capable of fighting at full strength. So I would discard that unit. Nice. What? You want to watch your show? Okay, 1 second, team. Wow. There you go. Watch a level. There. Put something new for the kiddo. All right, so my mortar attack successful. I discarded. They're not going to move. So I'm just going to, if you destroy a unit, you can follow up if you have like a rifle unit or a tank unit. Normally you're not going to get a free move. But since this was fire and then I can move, I mean, I could move this unit if I want, but I don't want to move it. Yeah, I do. I'm going to move them up. Because if I can, I'm going to eventually move some folks into town. I guess they're going to move in here in a minute. Well, we'll just move them. But since they fired and now they've moved, they're activate. They go to the activated side. this unit here has a go. It's a rifle company. Now remember, your mechanized units are the only ones that can move diagonally. So he can do something. I'll move him up and he'll attack. So what we'll do is see if they can activate. I rolled a 3. So they meet the activation number. So they move. Boom, boom, boom. And now they get one attack. They're going to attack this unit here. And they have an 8 attack score. So I rolled a 3. So that rifle company moved up. And unfortunately, didn't do anything. Now, oh, I didn't point this out. Now, the reason why I know this unit died from one hit is because on the card, it has hit points. And this card had one health point. So I did one hit, 1 point of damage, that took it out. Some units have 2, in which case, if I needed a reminder, I could put a hit point of damage on them. All right, so that was all off of one star. So one star to activate this officer. That officer activated these two folks, and then they made rolls to see if they could do actions. So I would still have 3 more stars. One star I'm going to put on is the take directive markers. I probably should have done that first. These markers, you get 3 when you buy them. And again, these are the ones that let you add a point to different activities. Or if I failed an activation roll, I could use a directive marker and force the activation. And all the symbols you can do are located here on the token. So +1 combat, +1 movement, +1 defense. Turn a an infantry unit, give them perforating shots, which means they would have like bazookas to attack tank units, or force a unit to activate. So good reminders there. So that'd be his second star. Oops, bumped it. Then for my third star, says, you know, the other thing too is you can actually do these more than once. So I could activate all 3 units, use all 3 stars here, all 3 stars here. But thing is, with the directive token, since you can only have 6 maximum, theoretically, I mean, you know, really, I could only put 2 stars here and get all 6 tokens. You can have an unlimited amount of cards. So if I wanted, I could draw 3 cards and then deploy 3 units onto the board. I think right now I'm okay with what I've got. I don't have any suppression, so I'm going to activate another unit. I'm going to go ahead and activate, or attempt to activate, this rifle company. So, well, I don't have to attempt it because I spent the star on it. The star, when you spend it on the board, you automatically get to activate them. So they're going to move. Up. We're moving up to defend the town and take the town. And there's no shooting, so he's done. So that's all 3 of the stars for the American player. German player is going to do the same thing. Now, obviously, the turns go quicker because I don't have to explain things. You know, once you know how to play, you're just playing. So we're going to activate a unit for the Germans. And they have their own commander. Trying to move that, not as jerky. But they have their own commander. Now, he just simply says he can activate 2 units, but he has to be adjacent to him. The airborne commander, he could activate airborne units anywhere on the board. This gentleman doesn't have the luxury, so he can do 2 units, but he has to be adjacent to them. Plus, when you activate him, he automatically gets a directive marker. So we're going to activate him. Now, check this out. Since you can kind of split what you're doing between moves and actions, I could, now that he's activated, I'm going to take my directive token. I have a German directive token over here. So I'm just going to place that on his board. What I'm going to do is activate this guy, or attempt activation. Since I'm activating him with a go marker from a unit, he'll have to roll to see if he can do anything. Then I'll move and then activate this guy with his second order. I'm assuming that's what you can do, because that's what I've seen someone do in their playthrough video. Made sense to me. So, I said to myself, hey, if it makes sense, do it. Let's see if we can show a little bit more of the action here. Okay. So he's used up his stars, he got his activation token, or his directive token, he's done. So he's been activated. Then we're gonna have this unit over here, Ostrupen Company. They can move and attack. So what they'll do is they're gonna move back into town. And they're kind of surrounded, but they're gonna fight. What they're gonna do is actually go ahead and attack here. So they have attack value of 10. One of the officers in the German deck is the OST officer, and if the OST officer is within two squares of these OST units, they actually get a bonus to their attack. So instead of attacking at a 9, or instead of attacking at 10, they attack at a 9. But I don't have that particular officer. Now, this got the symbol of two suppressions. So, when in doubt on what an icon does, just let's look it up. So, it says times two passive. If this unit has an amount of suppressed tokens equal to the number written on the symbol, it is removed from the battlefield and placed back into its army deck. Oh. So, we don't want them to get a bunch of suppression. So they're going to attack here. They need a 10. Oh, wait. I can't do that yet. I have to roll for activation, which is a 5. And I rolled a 6, which rolled off camera. So because they did activate, they can move and they can attack. And they need to roll a 10. They rolled a 7, so they failed to attack. So that was their movement. An attack, so they're done with their activation. This unit here was also given a go by an on-field unit, so they had to roll. And he rolled a 5, if you can see that. Should roll the other die. So he's gonna move. He's gonna move up. And then he's going to attack this unit, and he also needs a 10. Rolled a 6. So these are not good units. So that's one star off of the German board here. And again, what I should have done was spent this right away. I'm going to go ahead and get three more. Now, if I had rolled better, like if I had rolled a 9, I could have spent my one directive token I picked up for free to make, to give myself a hit with my roll. But since I rolled really low, one of these tokens adding plus one to my die roll would not have helped. Oh, you know what I could have done though was if I had failed an activation roll, again, I could have activated it with that token. So anyway, that's two spent. I'm going to activate another unit. I'm going to do kind of what the Americans did. I'm going to go ahead and now activate my mortar unit. So I actually have a mortar unit over here. Let's take a look at the card. Okay, it is almost exactly like, get the focus here, almost exactly like the other. So these combat values are linked, so that means they're both at range of two. So this American unit is two away. I get two attacks at nine each. Now, because I put the activation token here on the board, I don't have to make the roll for activation. So the first roll of nine. Okay, I rolled a 7. Again, if I had rolled an 8, I could spend one of my directive tokens to make it a 9. And then I rolled a 4. So I'm not going to move that unit forward. We'll leave it right there for now, but it would be done. And that would be one turn. That would be one whole turn. So both sides have done all their stars, their activations, and they're good to go. And that's how the turn goes back and forth. We'll do one more turn now that we've seen kind of how this goes. We take the stars off. and we take the activated tokens off. Everything would come off of the board except for any suppression or any hits. Hits and suppression stay on. So let's see. And the rules, the scenario says the American team goes first. Alright, so with them, I've got these three directives. I haven't used any. I'm just going to stay with those. I am, for the American player, going to draw three cards. Now, I shuffled these up ahead of time. So I'm just going to grab the top three. Now, let's see here. We picked up. Now, this here is a special event. So it says, let's try to just make this focus better. Double shoot. Play after successful hit. You inflict a second damage to your target. Good. So play after a hit. And here's another rifle company or rifle infantry regiment and a machine gun platoon. Now I can deploy up to three units. So the event card I'm going to keep in my hand. Let me move the German discard. So these units here, again, they can either place along your deployment edge, which you can't see. They can either place along the deployment edge or adjacent to a commander. Let's put the machine gun company in the woods because that's adjacent to a commander. And it's an airborne unit. Nice. And then here's a regular rifle infantry unit. They're not airborne. So I'll put them. Yeah, we'll just do that. Okay, so that was one star. Then my other star. I'm going to activate a unit, so I'll activate our officer. He is going to use his ability to activate two airborne units anywhere on the board. So we're going to activate my mortar platoon, which is airborne. Let's see if we can. Now, they can shoot up to two away. This unit right here is adjacent, so we'll go ahead and just attack them. So, because he was activated by an officer, and I got to pick another unit. We're going to do this unit here. Now, because they were activated by an onboard unit, they have to roll. So, he's not going to move. He's done. So, he's going to roll to see if he can shoot. He rolled a 5. He can. First attack is an 8. All right, so I rolled an 8. I need a 9 to hit. So I'm going to spend one of the American directive tokens. Make that a 9. So that's a hit, which would do 1 point of damage. But they're in town, so they're going to make a roll of 6 to save. Now, the German player will spend one of his directive tokens because that will let him add one to his defense. That's probably blurry. Blurry? Yeah, it's blurry. There it is. So he'll spend one on defense, so he'll discard that. And that unit is safe. My second shot with this unit is a miss. So the mortar platoon fails. Then this rifle unit will go ahead and make the attack because if they kill that unit, they get to move in. So they need to roll to activate. He rolled a 6, so he activates. Rolled an 8 to hit, which is the number he needs to hit. And he will inflict one hit. They will see if they get a save. They don't save. So this unit goes to the German discard. The American player advances after winning that battle, and his activation is done. And I have one more star to play. I'm just going to do another activation. This doesn't say it's mechanized. This isn't a mechanized. Mechanized would be if it actually had the tank unit or armored personnel, the other little vehicle symbol. This is infantry, so even though it's got a picture of a jeep, that doesn't make them mechanized. So I'm just gonna move them over here. Oh no, that's no cover there. I'm gonna leave them there. I can't move them into the water. Well, you know what? Why don't I activate this guy? I'm gonna activate these engineers. Engineers, because I activated them with the board, they're gonna move. Oh, and I did read that. Units, if you brought units onto the board in a turn, you can use them that turn. So I brought those on, so let me show you here. I could have, even though I brought those on this turn, I could have used them this turn. I'm gonna use my engineers that were sitting down here. So they're gonna move up. I don't have to roll because I used my board to activate them. They get a perforating shot of 8, and there's no save. So if this person was in a square with terrain, they wouldn't get a save. So we're just gonna make a roll of 8 or better. I rolled a 3. So engineers move up with flamethrowers and whatnot. No good. All right, so that would be the American player's turn. Then it just pops right over to the German player's turn. Again, he's going to take a look at his board, look at his actions. He's probably going to play similar. Let's get some more units on the board since we've lost a couple. I'm going to do draw 3 cards. One, two. What do we got? Panzer Grenadiers. Nice. Ooh, Stug. Ooh, my own engineers. All right, so check this out. This is a cool symbol. When you activate this unit, it can actually activate an infantry unit. As long as that infantry unit doesn't have any mechanized symbol attached to it, just a straight up infantry unit, which I have a lot of those. Problem is, I should have put the German board on the German tracker on this side of the board. I got them backwards, but we're going to deploy Stugs here. Oh, this might not be too bad. We'll place Panzer Grenadier here, and now it said adjacent. I didn't read that if diagonal counts as adjacent to your officer, so we'll just say it does. So I'm going to place all 3 units. Yeah. Here, I'll show you why. Let me swap this real quick. Now, once I go back and reread the rules, I'll probably see I could have done this better. But what I did was I placed my star on 3 cards. I drew all units that I could deploy. I have deployed them adjacent to this officer who's in the back. Now I'm going to take a star. We're going to take a look here. I'm going to activate a unit. I'm going to activate the commander. So we'll give him his go. He can activate 2 adjacent units and he gets a directive token. So I've got lots of these directive tokens now. He's not going to move, so what we'll do is we're going to activate adjacent. I don't remember if that. I know it's the movement was you can't move. So yeah, this should count. I'm going to activate the Stug unit or make the attempt, and we're going to attempt to activate Stern Pioneer. So this guy's done. I'm going to try to activate the Stug unit, and I'll show you why. So I have a 4 that I need. I rolled a 2. No, but I spend one of my directive tokens off the board, activate the Stug, and then check it out. His ability to activate an adjacent infantry. So I'm going to put a go on the adjacent infantry, and now he will attack. So the Stug has 2 attacks. Now, the rules didn't make it clear to me. It says perforating attacks pretty much can attack anything. Perforated has to be used against mechanized units. I guess that means it works just fine against infantry. So I'm going to take 2 shots against this rifle company. Now, this perforating shot, since these two values are separate, I wonder if you can see this better if I bring it up just to show an example. So I get two attacks, and I can split the attacks. I could put the perforating shot against, say, an enemy tank, and then the second attack against, infantry, because that's like machine guns, or they can all go against the same thing. But because their values are separated, only this value gets the perforating shot bonus. This being separate on its own is just its own regular 8th attack value. So I'm going to fire both shots at the rifle company. And because this is a mechanized unit, it can move. Oh, wait. You can't move diagonal on the follow-up attack. Darn. I almost placed that in a good spot. So we'll do the perforating shot of 8. Hey, an 8 hit. That's one wound. And I get a save roll because I'm in the building. And I make my save roll. Then the second shot of 8. I roll a 9. I get a save roll. I fail to save roll. I take one hit. This unit here has 2 health, so they're weakened. And he is activated. This unit will attempt to. We'll have the OST unit attempt to go. Since he activated by an on a card ability, he has to roll. He makes the 5, so he activates. He will shoot. He needs a 10. And I roll a 5. My directive only adds plus 1 to that, so that would be a waste. This unit has no need to move, so they're done. Then this Stern Pioneer Company, they'll roll. They activate. Their attack is an 8. And no save, because they got like a flamethrower. Oh, they miss. So a roll of 4 is terrible. Now they got a symbol right next to this, which is like an infantry and a 6. Let's take a peek at what that is real quick. Like I said, that's the only thing that's going to take me a while is to learn exactly what all the symbols are. So down here it says this unit grants to all adjacent infantry units a save of 6. Oh, well, that's good to know. I'm going to assume that's friendly units because I don't want to grant a save of 6 to my opponent. So anyway, he missed his roll. I have no need to move him, so he's done. Then the German player, according to their board, they have one more star to spend. So we will. What do I got to activate? Now you can't stack units, so my mechanized unit. I actually got a mechanized unit over here, but they can move diagonal. They just don't really have a whole lot of movement. So you know what I'm gonna do? I'm gonna swap with them. So what I'm gonna do on my board the swap. Swap two adjacent units. One of them can shoot. So I will swap with my Stugs. And then one of the units can shoot. They will shoot. They get 2 attacks. They have an 8. They have a 9. And they have that funky tank symbol with a 6. That means adjacent vehicle units would have an armor save of 6 if they weren't in any protective terrain. Nice. So my first attack of 8. Ooh, I rolled a 9. My daughter's trying to take her shirt off and she got stuck. Yes, I would help. Watch your show. She's gonna watch that for a second. Okay, so I hit, so that's one hit. So the infantry, they need to make a save roll. They failed a save roll. So that first hit from the mechanized unit destroys them. So that subtracts one victory point according to the rule scenario. So right now, the American player has plus 1 victory points, 2 for taking the city, minus 1 for being. An airborne unit getting destroyed. Bummer. Now, because it's diagonal, I'd have to look in the rule book, and that's the problem without having this all memorized. I know you guys like to look in rules. Let's see if we can find the follow-up real fast. After we kill something, can we move diagonal? Movement movement cannot be done diagonally. Yeah, so right here. So after you move a unit, your follow-on attack can't be, or your follow-on movement can't be diagonal. That's page 4 of the rules here in the, page 5. Movement after destruction. So, all right, so we killed that unit. They can't follow up. Now, I didn't put a go on them because the action was with the swap, and it just said they could shoot. So technically, that unit hasn't been activated for anything because they only get a go in an activation if you activate it. I just did a swap. But unfortunately, that's all three of my stars, so all three commands. That's the basics of the game. You know, we've covered quite a bit. I know some of the other playthroughs, people are so much more efficient at explaining rules and showing you guys stuff. But this is just a, you know, I think simple game. There's going to be a lot of cards, a lot more than what you have here, bigger boards. It's not difficult. It's just you got to get used to your symbols, and that's where the weakness is. Just like a field commander, you have to know your units and what they're capable of. And those icons are great reminders as to, you know, that you have special things that you can do. You just got to look them up every once in a while. But once you kind of have a flow for the game, it plays really, really well. So I hope this gives you an idea if you're interested in this card game or not. I think the highest tier right now was like $50, and then you get all the stretch goals. And they're getting a lot of stretch goals. And then they also had their first buy-on, which is the French Resistance. So there's no East Front or anything like that that I'm aware of, but this does a really good job, you know, for the West Front, because I can see that they're probably going to have like D-Day type scenarios and things like that. There is another card game, World War II card game, that just finished up on Kickstarter. I am aware of it, just in case someone's like, well, hey, what about this other one? I think it's like called 2GM or TGM or something like that. It was a Spanish World War II card game where you had your cards and the unit abilities on the cards. And that one covered like desert, East Front. It had a lot that it covered, more than Heroes of Normandy. So if you're not interested in the West Front, go look up that other card game. Now, its Kickstarter is done and over, so you'd have to wait for it to come out, you know, in production. But at least it will have other theaters for you to play with. I don't know if this is going to get other theaters, but I hope this gives you an idea if this is interesting for you or not. So thanks for watching. I appreciate that. And, you know, let me know what you think in the comments, and we'll see you later. Bye.